partners across the country.
Thank you. That concludes general questions. We turn now to First Minister's questions. Question number one from Ruth Davidson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the First Minister what engagement she has planned for the rest of the day.
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, let me express on behalf of the Chamber and our country my shock and sadness at the heinous attack on Westminster yesterday afternoon. We send our heartfelt condolences to those who have lost loved ones and our thoughts to all those who sustained injuries. Many of us in this chamber have friends and colleagues. Indeed, some of us have family members who work within the Palace of Westminster, parliamentarians, staff and journalists. Yesterday was a harrowing day for all of them, and they have our support and good wishes. Above all, we stand in solidarity with London, a vibrant, diverse, wonderful city that will never be cowed by mindless acts of violence. This attack stands, of course, as a stark reminder of the dangerous jobs that our emergency services do every day on our behalf. Yesterday, a Metropolitan Police officer went to work to protect and defend democracy and did not return home. Our thoughts and prayers are with the family of PC Keith Palmer. However, today we should also express our appreciation to policemen and women across the country who risk their lives every day in the line of duty. To the police and security staff who keep us safe here in our own parliament, we say thank you. Presiding Officer, in the aftermath of the attack yesterday, I was updated by the National Security Advisor and also on the immediate actions taken by Police Scotland. I convened a meeting of the Scottish Government's Resilience Committee last night. That was an opportunity to review what was known about the events in London, consider any implications for Scotland, and hear directly from the Chief Constable and other senior officers about their response. And I'm grateful to the Chief Executive of our Parliament for taking part in that meeting. I have been updated again by Police Scotland this morning. It is important to stress that there is no intelligence of any increased threat or risk to Scotland. However, as a precautionary measure, Police Scotland have increased security at key locations, including our Parliament, and will keep these arrangements under review. The public should also remain vigilant, but go about their everyday business as normal. Presiding Officer, we know that at times like these, it can be all too easy to look for someone to blame. It is important, therefore, that we are very clear about this. Acts of terrorism are not the responsibility of any one faith or section of our society. The only people to blame for acts of terrorism are the individuals who plan and perpetrate them. Let me end by echoing and endorsing the words of the Prime Minister. Terrorists seek to undermine our values and destroy our way of life. They will not succeed. Whatever our disagreements, in this chamber or any other, we stand united in our core values of democracy, human rights, and the rule of law. These values are strong and they will endure.
Ruth Davidson.
I thank the First Minister for that answer. On behalf of these benches, we express our deep shock at yesterday's events in Westminster. We too send our deep condolences to those whose loved ones were lost or injured yesterday. And once again, we express our gratitude to the police officers and security guards who at Westminster and here at Holyrood work to keep us safe, whose bravery we seem only to truly appreciate at a time like this. People like PC Keith Palmer, who lost his life yesterday doing his job, doing his duty. Yesterday, a coward killed three innocent people and injured many more in an attempt to attack the symbol of our country's democracy. His attack on our values failed as he died by the paramedics who demonstrated what a civilised society is by trying to save him. And his attack on our freedom will fail again today as we show our resolve by returning to work and getting on with our lives. So does the First Minister agree with me that as our representatives of democracy, we best demonstrate our defiance by showing here in Edinburgh and at Westminster that we will not be silenced and we will not be cowed, that we best strike back against terrorism by staying true to our own values of democracy, freedom and the rule of law?
First Minister.
Yes, indeed, I agree wholeheartedly with the sentiments expressed by Ruth Davidson. Those of us who have had the opportunity to see some of the proceedings in the House of Commons this morning can't fail to have been moved by the poignancy of what we witnessed. All of us feel very deeply the impact of what happened yesterday, but for our colleagues and friends in the House of Commons and in wider Westminster, going back to work today must have been difficult and harrowing, but the dignity that was expressed by the Prime Minister and indeed by other members of Parliament, I think, gives us all an example to follow. We have many disagreements. That is in the nature of democracy. We have seen that in our own Parliament over the past couple of days. But it is our ability to express these disagreements, often very passionately, that is the hallmark of our democracy. And it is the values of democracy, of human rights, of freedom, of the rule of law that terrorists seek to strike at. So whatever our disagreements, and undoubtedly before too long we will return to these disagreements here and in other places, but we have had the opportunity in these past 24 hours to remind ourselves of this, that we are all united by our common humanity, and it is democracy that defends our ability to have these disagreements and to express them in the way that we do.
Ruth Davidson.
I thank the First Minister for her answer. Can I ask her about the measures to protect people since yesterday's events? This morning, the Deputy Chief Constable at Police Scotland outlined some of those measures that have already been taken since yesterday's attacks. And as the First Minister has indicated, these include an increased police presence in our major conurbations and a substantial armed presence on our streets. The Deputy Chief Constable also described how yesterday, Police Scotland officers dropped everything to be in the right place. We again thank them for their actions. Can the First Minister today assure the Chamber that the police will be given all the support that they need to tackle this threat so the public are given the reassurances that they require?
First Minister.
I'm happy to give that assurance. I have indeed been assured by the Chief Constable that he has the resources he requires to respond appropriately, and there will continue to be, as I should say there always is, ongoing dialogue between the Scottish Government and our police service to ensure that they do have the resources that are required. The police have well-developed plans in place that enable them to increase security in response to incidents like the one that we witnessed yesterday. These plans yesterday were activated by Police Scotland and put into place immediately. There is an increased police presence around our major conurbations, and that, as people would expect, includes an increase in the presence of armed officers. Now, for reasons that I am sure the whole chamber will understand, I'm not going to go into precise detail about the police tactical response. It would be inappropriate and counterproductive for me to do so. However, that response does involve a substantial uplift in armed officers on duty and also a configuration of resources to ensure that there has been a high-profile non-armed police presence across the country. And many members of the public will have seen evidence of that this morning, I'm sure, as they have travelled to work. I, as I said in my initial remarks, have spoken to Deputy Chief Constable Gwynn this morning already to be updated, but also to continue to be briefed on how the police are responding. The arrangements that have been put in place will remain in place for the foreseeable future, but the police, of course, will continue to keep these arrangements under review. I am confident and therefore want to reassure the public that the police are doing everything that is appropriate to ensure the protection of the public. And I finally, Presiding Officer, would reiterate a point I made earlier on. The public, as should be the case at all times, should be vigilant. If they have concerns about anything, they should trust their instincts and contact the police. But the public should get on with their daily business, as we in this Parliament are getting on with our daily business. That, after all, is the best response to terrorists.
Ruth Davidson.
I thank the First Minister for the information that she is able to give the Chamber. As has been noted again today, we can never guard against attacks like yesterday's by building ever higher walls or bigger defences. And nor, as a free and liberal society here in the UK, should we wish to do so, even if it did work. As the Deputy Chief Constable also said this morning, the best defence against terror is a cohesive society which self-polices against the threat of extremism, a society which itself stops extremism from taking root and from poisoning vulnerable minds. So can the First Minister outline practical efforts that the Scottish Government is making to ensure we have the right community engagement in place to strengthen us all?
First Minister.
Well, I firstly would agree that, you know, it will always be a limit to what can be done to provide guarantees of protection. But whatever can be done should be done. I've already outlined the increased police presence that Police Scotland are making available. Those who heard the Deputy Chief Constable on the radio this morning will also have heard him talking about the specialist advice that is available to the police, including counter-terrorist security advisers, to advise on physical security barriers in place at key locations, for example. And it's important that we trust our police to take the right decisions in that regard. But there is a fundamental point here, that our best resilience does come from community resilience and the vigilance of the public. The police have been in contact with faith groups already over the course of yesterday, last night, and this morning. The Chief Constable has issued today a message to communities, a message of reassurance. The Scottish Government, as we do on an ongoing basis, will also be making contact with key groups in our society, key faith communities, to underline the important message of cohesion. Terrorists, by their very nature, seek to divide. Their intention, their objective, is to lead us to turn on each other, to look to people in our own society to blame. We must not do that. No faith group and no section of our society is responsible for what happened on the streets of London yesterday. And again, just as it is the best response to terrorism to go about our daily business confidently and defiantly, so too is it the right response to terrorism to unite as a society and to use that cohesion as a strength.
Ruth Davidson.
I thank the First Minister once again for her response. Presiding Officer, this has been a week when we have been reminded that terrorism has many faces. In Northern Ireland, the passing of a former Deputy First Minister there has brought back memories of the sickening violence that has played out in that part of the United Kingdom. Then the events in Westminster yesterday reminded us of the new terror threat that has dogged the United Kingdom and our allies internationally over the last two decades. Terror has come to our country in many forms and in many guises. It has not come from one religion or one group, but from the twisted worldview of individuals. So does the First Minister agree with me that the lesson here is not to tar one religion or one group in the coming days, but to tackle the evil of terrorist ideology itself? Not to vilify or blame whole communities, but instead to show that we all stand united against terror and stand united in defeating it.
First Minister.
I think the best and strongest message we can send out from our Parliament today in solidarity with our sister Parliament in Westminster and with the people of London and other parts of our world that have been blighted by the acts of terrorists is exactly that one. Whatever legitimate disagreements we have, we are united in those core values that we hold so dear. And at times like this, it is more important than ever that we come together to express those values and express our determination that terrorists will not divide us. And perhaps there is another lesson, and perhaps it is one particularly resonant for us here in this chamber at this time. We resolve disagreements by debate, by discussion, and by dialogue. That's what democracy is all about. And whatever we disagree on, what we all agree on is the importance, the vital importance of a vibrant democracy. And let that message ring out loudly from our Parliament today.
Question number two, Kezia Dugdale.
To ask the First Minister what engagement she has planned for the rest of the week.
First Minister.
I have engagements to take forward the Government's programme for Scotland.
Kezia Dugdale.
May I add the thoughts and prayers of these benches and this party to all those affected by yesterday's attack on Westminster, including the families of those who have died. In particular, can I pay tribute to PC Keith Palmer, who died doing what he did every single day, keeping people safe. Westminster means different things to different people. Our Houses of Parliament are a beacon of democracy for so many around the world. They represent freedom, tolerance, and the rule of law. But Westminster is also a place of work. For cleaners, catering staff, janitors, journalists, police officers, administrators, and many more, and many people are going to work today concerned about the safety of others. The police officers here in Scotland watching guard at train stations, the nurses who put themselves at risk every single day, and those who work in our schools who dedicate their careers to the enrichment of others. What assurances can the First Minister give us that everything that can be done is being done to ensure public safety?
First Minister.
Well, can I thank Kezia Dugdale for her question? She's absolutely right, I think, to draw attention to the fact that yesterday we were all reminded that Parliament at Westminster, just like our Parliament here, is not just a symbol of our politics and our democracy, although parliaments the world over are exactly that, but they are places where human beings go to work. Some of my oldest friends in life work within the Palace of Westminster. There will be many others in this chamber who can say exactly the same, and I will not be the only one whose first thoughts yesterday were about people that I love and people who I count amongst my dearest friends. And that is a reminder that politicians are human, the staff who work for them are too, the journalists who report on us. And at moments like this, it is that humanity that we are reminded of. I read a wonderful piece last night by the journalist Jonathan Friedland making that precise point, and I would recommend it to anyone who hasn't already read it. I've already outlined to Ruth Davidson the steps that Police Scotland have taken and will continue to take to make sure that they are guaranteeing, as far as can be done, public safety. But it is also important to work hard to guarantee public assurance. The police presence that many people will be witnessing on our streets today, higher profile than normal, it is not, and I stress this, and I think it's important to continue to stress this, is not because there is any intelligence whatsoever of an increased threat to Scotland. It is about assurance. The public understandably feel nervous and anxious in the wake of events like this, and therefore part of the job of the police is to keep us safe but also to contribute to that sense of assurance, and Police Scotland and all of us will continue to do that in the days ahead.
Kezia Dugdale.
Thank the First Minister for those words and that advice. London is a microcosm of the world. We know from the Prime Minister's statement just an hour ago that those injured yesterday were British, French, Romanian, South Korean, Greek, German, Polish and Irish. London is an open and multicultural city, home to people of all faiths and from many different and diverse nations. A city that last year elected Europe's first Muslim mayor. So no matter the religion, nationality or identity of the attacker, or those arrested earlier this morning, this cannot and must not turn into a war on any one community. Bringing people together must be part of the solution to combating terror. So will the First Minister join me in sending a strong message that Britain remains an open, tolerant nation that is home to people of all faiths and all nationalities?
First Minister.
Yes, I think that is an extremely important message. London is one of the most diverse and cosmopolitan cities in the world. 2 weeks ago today, I walked across Westminster Bridge on my way to the memorial service for Afghanistan and Iraq. And on that morning, Westminster Bridge was packed, as it is every morning, with people of all nationalities and all ages, at school parties, excited to be witnessing the Palace of Westminster and everything that the wonderful city of London has to offer. So we must remind ourselves that the victims of yesterday's attack would and could have been of all and any nationality. But it is also important to remind ourselves, as Kezia Dugdale has just done, that the responsibility for this attack does not lie with any faith or nationality. Terrorists seek to pervert religions, and we should not in any way contribute to their ability to do so. So this is an important moment for us to stand united and send that message. One of the issues I discussed both last night and again this morning with the Deputy Chief Constable was the need to be vigilant against any increase in hate crime in the days ahead. So all of us in this Parliament should unite to send that message. The only people responsible for terrorism are the terrorists, and let's make sure that message goes loudly and clearly.
Kezia Dugdale.
This is, of course, the second time in less than a year where we have faced an attack on our democracy here in Britain. And we have watched on in angst as terror has struck around the world from Belgium to Nigeria. In the days following the brutal murder of Joe Cox, we resolved that we have more in common than that which divides us. So does the First Minister agree with me that the best message we can send following this terrorist attack is that we will remain true to the values of tolerance and integration, freedom and solidarity?
First Minister.
Yes, I agree wholeheartedly with that. I'm sure many people yesterday in the immediate aftermath of the attack in London thought of Joe Cox and the incredible dignity with which her husband and her family reacted in the days immediately following her murder. I had the privilege of speaking to Brendan Cox last week and pledging the support of the Scottish Government for the activities that he is planning to commemorate the anniversary of her murder. But this is an opportunity for us all to remind ourselves of the values that she encapsulated and the values that all of us hold so dear. These are the values that terrorists seek to strike at. Their whole motivation is to divide, to undermine and to destroy the way of life that we hold dear. So just as we all did in the aftermath of the murder of Joe Cox, let us again today send that message to those who would commit acts of terrorism anywhere in the world, that they will not succeed, because whatever we disagree on, we are united by a rock-solid commitment to the values that Kezia Dugdale has articulated.
Question number three, Patrick Harvie.
Ask the First Minister when the Cabinet will next meet.
First Minister.
The Cabinet will next meet on Tuesday.
Patrick Harvie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. May I add, on behalf of my own party, our deep concern for all of those affected by yesterday's horrific events. The deepest sympathies for the friends and families of PC Palmer and all those who were killed yesterday. The respect and gratitude we all feel toward those who step forward in such circumstances, both bystanders who help the injured and the emergency services who showed professionalism and dedication, and our hopes for the recovery of those who've been injured. The lasting injury that some people wish to inflict upon us all is to destroy the empathy and solidarity which our society depends upon. So we must all be united in expressing and building that empathy and solidarity, in particular challenging those who would seek to blame, stigmatise and alienate people on the basis of their religion. There are those, sadly, in our society, in our media and in politics in this country and others, who are today reacting to these events by continuing to express racist, anti-Muslim and anti-immigrant sentiments. So as well as reflecting on the First Minister's comments about actions necessary to address security concerns, can I welcome the assurance that the First Minister has just given that the government will also respond robustly to any increase in hate crime and prejudice, and ask if the First Minister agrees that we must continue to confront any presence of such far-right threats in our society?
First Minister.
Yes, I do agree with that. Just as we have to stand strong against the terrorists, so too do we have to stand strong against anyone who would seek to exploit the acts of terrorists to sow division in our society. I think we are all acutely aware at times like this of the feelings, particularly within our Muslim community. People who feel as horrified, as shocked and as distressed as any of us do about the attack that happened yesterday, but who have often the additional burden of feeling that some in our society seek to blame them for these acts. So at this moment in time, at these moments in time, we must stand shoulder to shoulder with them. I know from my own constituency, which as members are aware, has a very high Muslim population, just how important it is to do that at this time. And that takes a number of forms. It is about reaching out, as I have already said, both police and the Scottish Government will do that across all faith communities in the days that lie ahead. It is about calling out anybody who seeks to respond to what happened in London yesterday with racism or intolerance or anti-immigrant sentiment. And it's about making sure that we are vigilant against hate crime and that the police respond vigorously to any crimes of that nature. And as I said earlier on, I've had an assurance from the police this morning that they will do exactly that. This is a moment for remembering what unites us as human beings, and that, in all of the different ways and forms that we have been discussing here this morning, is the most important message we can send.
Patrick Harvie.
May I also ask the First Minister to reflect on the children and young people growing up at this time who must also be looking on at these events? Their experiences, not only of what they see in the news of this attack and others, but also the experiences of our response as a society. These experiences will shape their understanding of the world around them. I grew up at a time when the Cold War created fears and insecurity, fears of violent destruction on an unimaginable scale, but I can barely imagine the impact of the brutal reality of yesterday's attack and others on those growing up today. What does the First Minister believe we can do within our education system and in our wider society to overcome those fears and ensure that young people grow up with those same values of respect and empathy that we've all spoken of, and with confidence in the capacity of humanity to stand together?
First Minister.
I think Patrick Harvie raises a very important point. I, like Patrick Harvie, like many of us in this chamber, grew up during the Cold War and grew up at a time when the fear of terrorism was Irish terrorism. And I remember very well, as many of us do, how real that felt at times. But what we didn't have to contend with then, as young people today do have to contend with, was the 24 hours a day, 7 days a week conveyance of news on social media, on Twitter, on Facebook, which I think we all recognise makes everything seem so much more acute, literally every second of every day. And therefore, I do think we have to be conscious of the impact on young people of that. But the other side of that, of course, is that social media makes this world smaller, and it gives our young people the ability to reach out to people on the other side of the world, to build common cause around those things that unite us as human beings. It's important that our education system does ensure that we instill those values that all of us hold dear, those common values. But we should also, in the way we respond, seek to lead by example, and that is something I think all of us in this chamber, across all of the parties, feel a responsibility for.
Question number four, Willie Rennie.
To ask the First Minister what issues will be discussed at the next meeting of the Cabinet.
First Minister.
Matters of importance to the people of Scotland.
Willie Rennie.
For 4 years, I would walk up Kennington Road and over Westminster Bridge. I'd look up to Big Ben and then down the Thames, dodging past the tourists taking pictures of this iconic scene recognised right across the globe. I would descend the steps and into the Palace of Westminster, nodding at the police officer who would nod in return. Morning, Mr. Rennie. It was the personal touch. I don't think I will be able to walk that route again without thinking of the people run over, the woman in the river, the police and the people injured. The three people who died, perhaps some, were tourists taking pictures. The officer who stood to defend democracy, but losing his life in the process. But I do want to be free to walk that route again. Now, getting the balance right between security and freedom is a difficult one. Does the First Minister agree with me that we must act based on security, expertise, evidence, and intelligence, and not fear?
First Minister.
Yes, I do. I agree very strongly indeed. I think Willie Rennie has just very movingly accounted his own experiences of making the journey that many of those who work within Westminster would have made yesterday morning. Those of us who have never worked within Westminster, though, can relate to our own experiences of coming to work in this building, nodding and saying good morning to the police officers and the security staff. The security staff in here, many of them who have been with us, those of us who've been in this parliament since 1999, from the very beginning, people that we have come to think of, not just as colleagues, but as friends. They work every single day around the perimeters of this building and in this building to keep us safe. And yesterday was a reminder of just how much we owe each and every one of them. Willie Rennie is right, though. At times like this, there is, of course, a desire on the part of the public to know that the police and the security services, who we haven't mentioned yet, but it is a reminder. Yesterday is a shocking event, but the rarity of what happened yesterday is a tribute to the security and intelligence workers who keep the country safe at all times. But it is understandable that in response to an attack like yesterday, people's instinct is to worry about security, and that is right and proper, and I feel very strongly the responsibility I have shared with others as First Minister to make sure we are doing everything we possibly can to guarantee the security of the public. But the balance has to be right. I don't want to, and I don't believe anybody wants to live in a country where we allow the fear and the threat of terrorism to restrict and to undermine how we live our lives, because that would be allowing the terrorists to get what it is that they want. So we have to make sure that there is a balance and a proportionality in what the police do. And having discussed yesterday and today, and you know, I discuss on an ongoing basis, periodically with the police, the plans that are in place, I am confident that they have that balance very firmly in mind. We have to keep the public safe, but above all else, that is keeping the public safe for a purpose, to allow the public to get on with their day-to-day lives, because that is the most important thing.
Willie Rennie.
Yesterday was particularly horrific because the scene was so familiar. We've all seen it on our televisions or witnessed it ourselves. But these acts of terrorism happen abroad as well as home almost every day. And we must do all we can to protect our open, free and liberal society. Never generalising, never stigmatising, reaching out to all faiths, religions, countries and creeds. Now, although the attacker yesterday was born here, his violent ideology is one that pervades the globe. That is why we must act together with our partners wherever they are in the world. It's about defence, security, intelligence, but also soft power. Soft power through international aid, diplomacy and partnerships. Does the First Minister agree with that?
First Minister.
Yes, I do. I think there's two points there that I think are worth underlining. The first is indeed the first one that Willie Rennie made. Of course, acts of terrorism that happen here at home on our own shores or on the shores of our nearest neighbours will always impact more forcibly on us than acts of terrorism that happen further afield. But it is really important that we recognise that many countries across the world deal with events like this on a very, very regular basis. I was struck yesterday watching the television, and a tourist was interviewed, and he was from Turkey, and he made that point that he was shocked by what had happened yesterday, but he came from a country where these incidents were sadly a regular occurrence. And I think that is a reminder that we probably all have an obligation to give more attention to acts like this that happen in other parts of our world. Second point that I think is worth underlining, and you know, this is a point again that is resonant in the age we live in. Whatever relationships there may be at any time between different countries, the importance of all countries working together on security, on defence, on intelligence are vitally important. And again, you know, perhaps the theme of our discussions this morning, if we were to draw one out, is this. Whatever our disagreements, whatever different relationships we may want from time to time, there are many, many things that, regardless of all of that, unite us. Not just the human values that we have spoken about, but the common interest that we all have to work together to combat terrorism and keep our populations safe.
Thank you. Can I thank the First Minister and all our party leaders for their contributions? We're going to move now to supplementary questions. Question from Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, this morning the Edinburgh Evening News revealed that NHS staff patients and visitors will face an increase in parking charges from £7 to £15 per day. Does the First Minister think it is fair for our hardworking NHS staff to face the more than doubling of parking charges to go to their work? What advice does the Scottish Government give to the NHS boards in Scotland regarding parking charges for NHS staff? And will the First Minister back my call to NHS Lothian to scrap the staggering 114% increase in parking charges?
First Minister.
I share the member's concern about this, and I actually agree with him. I don't think it's fair to patients and to visitors to the Edinburgh Royal Infirmary. As some members will recall, when I was the Health Secretary, we abolished parking charges at all NHS-run car parks across the country. There were a small number of sites, Edinburgh Royal Infirmary being one of them, where it was not possible to do that because of the private finance initiative schemes in place. The cost of doing that would have been out of proportion in any sense of affordability. And you know, NHS Lothian, I know in years gone by, have looked closely at this, as has Scottish Government officials. I will happily ask the Health Secretary to discuss this matter again with NHS Lothian. These contracts, and I'm not seeking to make a political point, today is not the day for that. These contracts predate the life of this government, but we will continue to look again to see whether there is anything that can be done. But I hope that it helps to explain the context for the important issue that the member has raised.
Question number five, Christine Graham.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I don't know whether I should declare an interest to ask the First Minister what forward planning is in place to meet the demographic challenges of an ageing population.
First Minister.
I think Christine Graham should almost certainly declare an interest. I will pay a heavy price for that attempt at lightening the mood in the chamber. Scotland's ageing population is one of our most significant challenges as a society, but it's also, and this is a point that we don't make often enough, also one of our most significant assets. And we want to ensure that older people can continue to contribute and participate to their fullest potential. That's why across the government, the needs of our ageing population have been embedded into all of our planning, and we continue to work with National Records Scotland on future population projections. From health and social care, planning and housing, to combating social isolation and supporting people who want to keep on working, we are ensuring that we're doing all we can to support people to enjoy a thriving third age.
Christine Graham.
I thank the First Minister in part for her reply, and I want to congratulate the Herald on their Grey Matters campaign, which we surely all endorse. But given that currently 17% of the Scottish population is under 16, whereas 18% is over 65, and that over the coming 25 years, the number of over 65s is predicted to rise by 53%, and over 80s from 77,000 to 200,000, which even now and will in the future impact, as the First Minister has understood, in housing, health, transport and so on. Will the First Minister commit to appointing a dedicated Minister for Older People to work across all government portfolios to provide the best support we can for older people in Scotland? And for the avoidance of doubt, First Minister, this is not a job application.
First Minister.
But if asked, I'm sure. Anyway. I will obviously give consideration, although I would say that it is the responsibility of all ministers to make, because this is an issue that cuts across every responsibility of government. So it's the responsibility of all ministers to make sure this is embedded in our planning. Can I also commend the Grey Matters series of articles that has been running in the Herald this week? I think it has been an excellent contribution to raising the profile of the many different issues that are raised by this issue. I agree with Christine Graham's comments, and I will reiterate what I said, that across all different responsibilities of government, we are very mindful of how we respond to what is a challenge and an opportunity. My final point would be this, though. There is obviously a crossover here to the debate about migration and freedom of movement. One of the things I feel very strongly about is that we all have a responsibility not to dismiss the concerns people have about immigration, to address those concerns, but also to focus people's minds on the economic necessity we have as a country because of the demographics that Christine Graham has just outlined to grow our population. and the contribution of some of the best and brightest talents from across Europe and the world has a significant part to play in that. So there are many issues here that government has a responsibility to take forward, and we will make sure we do that and do so in consultation with others across the Parliament.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In December, it was my great privilege to chair a meeting of the Older People's Forum in this very chamber. At one point in the afternoon, I asked those present about what they were most worried or anxious, and I was very surprised to learn that it was fear of falling was topped that list. A few weeks ago, this Parliament passed an amendment in my name calling for a national falls strategy to build upon the work of the 2014 falls framework, but with resources and adequate awareness-raising capabilities. I wonder if the First Minister could tell the Chamber what steps her government plans to take in this regard.
First Minister.
Well, I'll ask the Health Secretary to write to the member with detail of how we are in a coordinated way across government in partnership with local authorities, with health boards, with the voluntary sector, making sure that we are working to combat the fear and the risk and the consequences of falls amongst older people. It doesn't surprise me to hear that that was the fear that older people expressed most often. Many older people, as they get older, have an increased risk of falling, and that in itself is a source of that fear. But for many older people, the consequences of having a fall can be really severe and can have a significant impact on their independence and ability to live independently. So it's important that we take an approach to this that is first and foremost a preventative approach, but also one that is dealing quickly and appropriately with the implications and consequences of falls, so that we can ensure that older people do retain that ability to live independently, notwithstanding that they have suffered a fall. So I will ask the Health Secretary to write to the member with more detail about the specific work that is being taken forward.
Question 6, Grahame Simpson.
To ask the First Minister what the Scottish Government's response is to reports that in 2015, around 1 in 5 referrals to child and adolescent mental health services were rejected, and over the last 3 years, approximately 17,000 children and young people have been affected.
First Minister.
All children referred to specialist child and adolescent mental health services are assessed on an individual basis. If through that assessment a clinician does not believe that CAMHS is the best course, then of course we would expect the child to be referred on to an appropriate service. Next week, as the Chamber is aware, the Mental Health Minister will be bringing forward our new 10-year mental health strategy. I'm able to tell the Chamber today that one of the early actions of that strategy will be to commission an audit of rejected referrals. And the findings from this audit will help ensure that children are being referred to the right services and that those services are able to provide the help that children need.
Grahame Simpson.
Thank you for that answer. That's very encouraging. Half of all adults who are mentally ill experience the onset of their mental health problems by the age of 15. So if we can identify and support young people early on, we can make a real difference. According to SAMH, 3 in 10 young people in classrooms across Scotland have a mental health problem. We're not going to close the attainment gap unless we address the mental health needs of children and young people. Children and young people live in 5 NHS board areas, including my own Lanarkshire, where the 18-week target is not being met. One NHS board, Lothian, reports a medium wait of 20 weeks. SAMH has called for mental health targets to be reduced to 12 weeks, in line with other waiting time targets. Does the First Minister think that's achievable?
First Minister.
With the general thrust of Grahame Simpson's question, if we are able to identify mental health problems in younger people, then obviously we prevent problems deteriorating later in life. And indeed, it is that view that will ensure that CAMHS is a central part of the strategy that we outline next week. He's also right to raise the issue of waiting times. There is progress being made towards meeting the 18-week waiting time. There are some boards who are further behind than others, and we are working closely with those boards to support them in accelerating progress. I've said this in the chamber before, one of the things I think we should be positive about, counterintuitive although this often sounds, is the fact that there are more people, young and old, being identified with mental health issues and coming forward for support. Because I've said before, what that means is that the stigma that has so often prevented people seeking support in the past is fading. And that's a good thing that we should all welcome. But that places a responsibility on the shoulders of government and of services across the country. It is counterproductive to encourage people to come forward for help if they cannot then access that help in a timious way. That's why the aspects of the strategy that I've already spoken about, the others will be outlined by Maureen Watt next week, are so important. We are increasing support for mental health services. I announced at the weekend some moves that we're making, not just within the health service, but within our criminal justice system as well. This is one of the most important issues, not just in our health service, but across our society that we face. And I hope that while I'm sure there will be a lot of very robust scrutiny when the strategy is outlined next week, I hope we can also build a lot of consensus around what it's seeking to do.
Thank you. And that concludes First Minister's questions. We're going to move now to members' business in the name of Ben McPherson. We'll just take a few moments for members to change their seats.